I am really delighted to be here amidst this excellent gathering here of all retailers. My association with REI goes back to the days when it was founded by 7 retailers in the country, and I was fortunate to be representing one of the retailers at that time. And I think I must really congratulate the current team headed by Kumar Rajagopalan for exponential growth of REI in the last few years. I think we all have been watching the kind of work being done by REI, and it's really, really commendable. So congratulations, Kumar. I think undoubtedly this is India's time, and India continues to be now, for probably the 3rd year in a row, the most attractive market for everyone, global as well as domestic investors alike. I think the story about our GDP growth, our young population, working age population, is all well known. And I'm not going to really harp on that anymore. But I think certainly one point which is worth mentioning, which is making us more attractive in the world, is the focus on ease of doing business by both center and the state. And while efforts that are taking place in the background are enormous, the results on the ground do take some time. We have been engaged deeply through, and I personally also have been engaged deeply through various industry bodies, but even also with some of the government functionaries directly, and I can tell you that the quality of engagement is really very, very superior. Today, I think the ministers as well as the government officials are really keen on growth and helping industry grow. I would really applaud the efforts being made by the government, and also want to mention 2 key ones. I know that sometimes demonetization doesn't get the credit which it needs to get for formalization of economy, but demonetization has played an extremely important role in the formalization of economy. More importantly, GST has made a huge difference. With all the teething troubles behind us by and large, I do believe that the impact of formalization is being seen. I think the GDP growth last quarter of 8.2% is a testimony of the same. The second half of this year, FMCG companies as well as retail can really look forward to some good growth, and we are looking forward to a great Diwali this year. I would like to be very specific about 3 points that I want to make. Number one is that retail is at the front end of entire chain and not at the back end, not as the last element in the chain. And this point, once it is driven home, that retail drives consumption, which in turn will drive demand, which drives manufacturing, make in India, which in turn drives jobs, per capita income, and therefore will further drive consumption. I think this point is so important to understand, and I'm glad that policymakers recognize this point now. And retail is getting the attention from the center and the state alike. The supply side is so important to drive healthy consumption. I was listening intently to Shri Pawan Agrawalji's statements about promoting eating right, the Eat Right movement. And I think it's so valid. So when you, and this focus on food retail, so way back 20 years ago, food retail, the talks about food retail was very limited. Most of the retailers, organized retailers, were in the space of apparel retail. And today you see that there is a big focus on food retail. Food security is the most important global issue today. And when you think about food waste and one third of the food going waste globally, nearly 35 to 40% of the food going waste in India, waste on the plate as well as waste from waste in the farm and farm to fork, I think these are real issues which retailers have the ability and the power to tackle by working with the supply chain in a very focused manner. I can tell you that we on our part do focus on food waste and reducing food waste constantly by working through the chain, working on food safety by once again adopting certain principles. And I think more needs to be done in the area, for instance, of blockchain, which can play an important role in the whole process. The second, so one is about the engine of growth. The second is about the key point about retail and in terms of creation of shared value and the role it plays in terms of inclusive growth. Retail probably and probably by far is the only industry which really creates jobs across skilled, semi-skilled, and to a certain extent even unskilled labor. And more importantly, I think it helps in skilling people. REI itself plays an extremely important role through Rashi, but more importantly, overall in the supply chain, when you think about retail being able to create direct and indirect jobs, and the skill development that takes place in the whole process, I think it's, I would call it a huge creation of shared value in the process. If I was to give you some examples from our own business, from Walmart, every cash and carry store that we put up, we've done a study that it creates about 2,000 direct and indirect jobs in the entire supply chain. And therefore, when you start multiplying the effect of that and look at the impact that retail investments can make over a period of 10 years, we have the ability to create thousands of jobs in the country. A McKinsey study has stated that we need to create 115 to 120 million jobs over the next 10 years, which is about a million jobs a month. And by virtue of some studies that we have done, and with the kind of investments that we are currently making, we have the ability to contribute at least 8% of that requirement. So creating about a million jobs a month in the next 10 years, I think will be a huge contribution. The third part is about supply chain and logistics. Investment in retail necessarily precedes investment in backend. And particularly when you talk about food and food waste and food security systems and food supply chain, I think this investment in backend will play an extremely important role. So supply chain and logistics in the country is now set for transformation, particularly with GST coming into play and one national market being formed. When I look at, let me speak a little more about how we look at the country, how Walmart looks at the country. I think clearly, of course, with the kind of partnership and investment and the recent investment in Flipkart, Walmart is committed to the country. And we do see a great value in terms of an omni-channel play in the whole process. The digital, I would not call digital as disruption, digital is really an opportunity to improve the overall productivity and efficiency very, very significantly. Whether you talk about artificial intelligence or you talk about Internet of Things, talk about blockchain technologies, talk about virtual reality, I think these are all really good opportunities to significantly improve the human productivity. And we do not believe that these things will replace humans, but I think overall productivity needs to rise quite significantly. Mr. Pawan Agrawal made the point regarding the overall global population going from 7.5 billion to 9 billion by 2050. And then when you start looking at the requirement of just the food and don't look at the other essential commodities which are necessary, I think the overall food production and sustainable food production needs to increase tremendously. And that productivity gain will come from many of these things which a digital economy will help us develop. One important point as far as retail is concerned, retailers have an extremely important role to play in what I call, and what actually Michael Porter calls, creation of shared value. It's not about philanthropy, it is not about CSR, it is about creation of shared value. And what is a good strategy or what is good for the business is also good for the society. And let me give you some examples. Our direct farm program that we do in the states of Punjab or UP or Andhra and Telangana, where we work with small farmers in terms of helping them understand the ways to improve productivity of their land, yield of their land, and what crops to plant in which season, and where is the demand in the future. These are not philanthropic steps. These help us in terms of running our business better. While we may not be procuring the entire produce from them, and they are free to sell to anyone, it helps them realize better prices. So creation of shared value by retailers is about making your own business profitable by cutting down waste from farm to fork, being able to make those products available to the consumer at low prices and therefore increase sales and consumption of healthy food products in the stores. But creation of shared value also happens because you're helping the farmers double their income. Organized, and let me give you a concrete example of a few women farmers whom I talked to in the store of, in our Lucknow store. And I said, why do you want to deal with Walmart? Or for that matter, any other, replace Walmart for any organized retailer. And there were two or three very good reasons they gave. Number one is that when we bring produce to your store or when we give it to your people, wherever it is collected, it is weighed and measured properly. We get the full value. Number two, we get payment on time. If you say 15 days, we know that on the 15th day, money will be credited in my account. And third, and which was an eye-opener for me, the third and the most important point, of course, the, one of the points, of course, was that you help us in terms of increasing our yield and our produce because your people help us in terms of giving us feedback, that apart. But the very important point was we get payment for our last produce or last delivery of the season, implying thereby that maybe sometimes in the past in the unorganized sector, the last crop did not even get them the payment. So if you look at end to end what retailers can do, what organized retailers can do to double farmers' income, this is really phenomenal. The second area where organized retailers can play an extremely important role, and I'll give you once again our own example. In all our 18 out of 20 stores, we generate 30% of our electricity requirement through solar panels on the roof. And so this is certainly renewable energy, But it, more importantly, it has also cut down our utility cost. And encouraged by the reduction in the utility cost, which straight goes into the bottom line, and which helps us further cut the prices for the consumers, we said that we will put rooftop, or we'll cover our parking lots with roof, and we are experimenting in one of the stores, and that rooftop will have solar energy, and when the cars are parked in summer season in the north, cars will have shade. So look at the creation of shared value for the customers who come into the store, for us as a retailer, where we reduce cost of utility, and overall we work on renewable energy, and further go to from 30% to maybe 50% of our requirement being met through renewable energy. So when you start looking deeply into every single aspect of your business, particularly in retail, of running the store, and how to bring down the SG&A or the cost of running a store, there are so many opportunities to do it in a sustainable way that it's really amazing to work with some of the leaders in the industry in the whole process. And the third area which I would like to emphasize in terms of creation of shared value is women's economic empowerment. So gender equality or gender inequality is an extremely important social issue. But it's also an extremely important opportunity for creation of shared value, because women are our consumers as well. They understand the product a lot more than men do. And therefore, women entrepreneurship development program is something which retailers can run, where more and more women are encouraged to come into business and become job creators. So women in factories program, women in retail program, diversity and inclusion within the workforce, as well as women entrepreneurship development, these are some of the things, some of the programs that we run in the space of women economic empowerment, that I would strongly urge retailers to look at, and we are happy to share more information about most of these programs, where I think it will be good for the business as being strategic, but certainly good for the country and good for the economy, where gender equality is an extremely important issue. And finally, I think an opportunity which we still need to exploit a lot more, and where we need to play a bigger game, is skill development programs. And I have known about RASI for a long time, and when I was listening to Mr. Kumar Rajagopalan's presentation today, the thought going on in my mind was, how can Walmart also now work with RASI in the whole space of skill development? So once again, it is a great opportunity for us as retailers to engage in that space and make a difference in terms of the skill development efforts in the country. With these thoughts, I would like to conclude my remarks by saying that this is really the time for entrepreneurs to make some big, bold bets in the space of retail and in the space of omnichannel retail, I would suggest. I think while I can say that to a certain extent, the investment made by Walmart has certainly triggered a lot of interest in the ecosystem. And generally, I think foreign investors and domestic investors are looking at retail and omnichannel space with renewed interest. I think it is an opportunity for a lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of startup entrepreneurs to come into the space and become job creators in the country and create value for themselves as well as for the ecosystem. Thank you very much.